Greetings, citizens, and welcome to a special episode of Real Comic Heroes Podcast. I'm Travis.
And I'm Patrick.
And this episode, we are joined by a special guest. We've got all the way from the future, Glasgow's favorite son. We've got Rory.
Hi, Aiden. I don't know about that part just yet. Billy Connolly's still around.
Okay.
Good call.
Right, thanks for the lovely intro anyway. Lovely to be here.
Yeah, I tried not to draw it out too much.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, because we have a special uber nerd movie.
Yeah.
Yep. You're a special talk about... uber nerd to guest.
Yep. All right.
So for those not aware, Rory hosts a YouTube show called Hangover Reviews.
I will say my number one hangover was we had a rough night, rough morning, and we watched Dawson's Creek all freaking day.
Dawson's Creek has an interesting one.
Yeah, I never thought I'd watch that.
Yeah,
it was perfect. I could just space out and.
Well, that's the sort of idea of why I started this. Me and my friend, when they were hungover and watched. What was it? The Switch, Jason Bateman film. Just this like easy rom com, pretty much, and yeah, it was perfect. You know, that's where the idea came from originally.
Okay, yeah, it's like that body switching movie you always see. Usually a mom and daughter,
yeah.
But this time it was Bateman and Reynolds. Was it?
No, that's Bateman. The change up.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, what the heck's the switch?
The Switch is sperm being switched.
He finds out he has a kid.
Oh, okay, that's right.
With Jennifer Aniston.
Yeah. Bateman confuses me.
Yeah.
He's in too many things.
A real bait and switch.
Oh.
Bait and switch.
Wow.
Wow. I had to start it off at a low note so that we could build from there.
Okay, well, it's not going to get any worse than that, folks. Okay, switch and change up, same thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Now I'm on the same page as you. There's too many movies.
Yeah.
That is.
I mean, Spaceball, Star Wars.
Same thing, right?
Okay, maybe that was the worst part. Okay.
I'm just glad I finally have an ally to, against Spaceball.
Wait until you see my review of Star Wars.
Oh, no.
Worst ever. I think I like Geely better. So, yeah, I guess we're talking about Star Wars this episode.
We're not.
Episode 4, Back to the Past, New Hope. I don't know what you call it.
I call it Star Wars, Patrick.
Okay.
I try and call it Star Wars, and then no one knows what you're talking about, so you have to see
episode
4, New Hope, or whatever.
Like the new one, or the old one, or the one that's... old that's really newer in the timeline?
Yeah, you can't even say the first one, because that confuses people.
I know. Wait, the old first one or the new first one?
Or the new first
right,
one.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, I had a heck of a time trying to actually get a hold of this movie.
Oh, really?
Because you can't stream it anywhere.
No, yeah.
Like,
not unless you pay for it on iTunes.
Well, I mean, like, even that, you can't rent it.
Oh, you have to buy it?
You have to buy it straight out. So I had to go to a video store like a savage.
Wow.
I was this close to having to get a VHS copy. It's like, what the hell? This is Star Wars. Get it together there, Disney.
They ought to send it out in the mail with samples of Tide.
Oh. What is it, in the vault or something at Disney? I don't get it. That was so weird.
So, but you did manage to watch the special edition... You know, the more recent version of Star Wars.
If by recent edition you mean obviously CG,
yeah,
then well, yes.
The one where Han shoots second? ish.
Yeah, there was a weird jump cut, so it was hard to tell. But yeah, that's the one I watched.
Okay.
But yeah, it took me a while to figure out if I had the right one, because they all had the same box art.
Yeah.
Stupid family video.
Why don't we start off by talking about kind of like our Star Wars history, if you will. Like,
okay.
You know, where, when we first watched it, you know, what it, you know.
Okay. If
that makes sense.
Well, I'll let you guys go first.
Okay. So for me, I was, Star Wars was always kind of in pop culture, but I was aware of it, but honestly, the biggest, I guess the first example of Star Wars I ever was aware of was in Muppet Babies. Do you remember, like, I don't know if you ever watched it, but they'd open a door and there'd be, you know, the TIE fighter versus Falcon scene or some kind of moment from Star Wars. So I think that's honestly where I first, you know, became aware of it. And then obviously it just was fairly prevalent. I mean, it was born in 83, so I probably wouldn't have become aware of it until 5 or 6 years later at the earliest. But it wasn't like super into it. I probably got most into Star Wars around the time of Phantom Menace. Because they had released the special editions a couple years before then. And I think we had a crappy VHS copy, like, recorded off of HBO. Like, that was my version of Star Wars, was just watching it on, you know, a recorded version. But really, once they started ramping up the hype with Phantom Menace, that's kind of when I got into it. And I got into Phantom Menace in a big, bad way. Like, I bought all the action figures from the entire Series 1. I had all of those. So, you know, say what you will about the prequels, and we'll get into those later. But honestly, that's what got me into Star Wars for the most part.
So. Okay. Mine's kind of a similar story as well. I was 8 when Phantom Menace came out, so target age, I think. And I don't really remember seeing Star Wars at all for the first time. It was again, probably had it recorded off the TV and watched it 100 times before that, but I have no memory of seeing it for the first time. Then, when Phantom Menace came out is when I really got into it and bought all the toys and everything.
Jeez, okay.
Yeah.
Well, let's see. I got to Star Wars through Indiana Jones because I liked Indiana Jones so much. I looked up like other movies that Harrison Ford was in, and I found out about Star Wars. Nice. So it was probably like, and oddly, I saw the Return of the Jedi first, because that's what my cousins had on the TV. So, so I didn't see it in the correct order. I think I saw it on VHS because, again, I was born in 81, so that was like around the time of the second one, I think, or maybe...
Empire was 80.
Okay, so just after Empire then?
Yeah.
So yeah, I saw Return of the Jedi, I think in like 88 or something, when I was like 7.
Yeah.
And I just liked it for the action. I wasn't really into the story because I didn't quite understand, plus there was those little Ewok guys, and I thought they sounded funny.
Yeah.
But yeah, the newer ones, from the Clone Wars forward, I think I enjoy the animated version of the Clone Wars better.
Better than the prequels?
Than the prequel movies.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I'm sure there's a lot of people that are like that.
Yeah. I know that the new Rebels show has a really big following.
Yeah.
But I haven't watched any of it.
Yeah, I haven't either.
Yeah.
So yeah.
I think
Harrison Ford.
Yeah, right on. That's not a bad way to get into Star Wars. You know? So, I mean, I'm sure for the most part, anyone born in the 80s has that similar, like, I don't remember the first time I saw Star Wars. You know, it was just always there, so.
Yeah. Yeah, because I think it was like another 2 years after that I saw the one we watched, New Hope. Because I didn't realize there were other movies before.
Yeah. Yeah, it's unfortunate that, you know, I wish I knew or wish I remembered seeing Star Wars for the first time, you know. And it's probably one of those that probably around the special editions is the first time I ever watched them, like, start to finish, probably, in a, you know, non-recorded off of TV on a, you know, crappy VHS, you know, so.
Yeah, I mean, having watched it after watching a hell of a lot of Bonds and Planet of the Apes movies.
Yeah.
I can see why this was a big deal.
Yeah.
So I have some, like, timeline connection to why this was such a big movie. Because it's sort of, I think of it now as I think of Terminator 2, The Matrix.
Okay.
Like, they were revolutionary for their time.
Yeah. Every decade or so, you have that big.
Yeah. Because, like, T2, you had, you know, the weird Mercury looking special effects, and then obviously Matrix, you got the bullet slow motion 360 thing that got killed to death, but it was still cool at the time.
Yeah.
So I put that in there.
Right now. And like last time you had said that you haven't watched Star Wars in what, 10 years?
At least. Yeah.
Something like that. So that's interesting. I mean, I watched it right before Force Awakens with my niece, I'd seen Force Awakens, and she had never seen Star Wars. She's 13, so it was kind of all new to her, so it was kind of cool seeing her watch it, getting into it. So let's see. Rory, are you like me, where you'll kind of sit down and watch these, you know, every year or so?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I've watched this now like three times in as many months now, just circumstance, and it doesn't get older. I can watch it again. I could watch it again after we're done here and enjoy it as much. So,
yeah. Huh. Yeah, and you recently reviewed the entire prequel and original trilogy for your show, right?
Yeah, I did, yeah.
Okay. All right, so let's, why don't we actually start talking about the movie?
Okay. It's about an ungrateful teenager that runs off with an old man and some robots.
Pretty much. So according to IMDb, Luke Skywalker joins forces with a Jedi Knight, a cocky pilot, a Wookiee, and two droids to save the galaxy from the Empire's world-destroying battle station, while also attempting to rescue Princess Leia from the evil Darth Vader. So, you know. I like that Star Wars is so ingrained in pop culture that this synopsis can say a Wookiee.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it doesn't have to explain.
It's Jedi Knight as well.
Jedi Knight, yeah. So that's kind of tells you how, you know.
Yeah, because that's a very assuming you know stuff
exactly.
kind of synopsis.
Yeah.
It's like, so is this about, like, knights in armor? What?
Right.
What the hell's a Wookiee?
Who wants to jump in with their first point?
First of all, I didn't have any notes on the crawl because
I
never really read it anymore.
see, I read it every single time.
Really?
Yeah, I don't know why. It's like, it's always not new, but it's always, to me, kind of exciting. Just, I don't know. It's different, you know. It's only Star Wars has that.
Yeah, yeah.
Aside from, you know, spoofs or whatever, but,
it had to be weird seeing that in a theater.
Yeah.
For the first time. Like, the crawl just, like, zooming up the big giant screen.
Yeah.
From what I've always heard, like, Lucas based that on the old serials that he watched as a kid, so maybe that was kind of common.
Yeah.
But hadn't been done probably for
Akira Kurosawa films that he based a lot on that do that as well.
Okay.
Not in the same sort of way. It's just like text rolling up the screen, like straight up, like in front of like a landscape or something.
Okay.
Yeah, because I was like, hey, I'm here to watch a movie. I'm not here to
read.
Jeez.
Okay. So, yeah. My first note was, you know, I like how you don't know what's going on, but you see these two massive ships.
Yeah.
Well, you see one ship and you think it's, you know, big, and then you see the other one just, going on and on. It's, you know, done really well. And just the score, like, really ramps up the tension. You don't know what's happening necessarily.
I think it's quite cool that when you see those two ships, you automatically know who the bad guys are.
Like, yeah.
You know the guys in the big, pointy, scary-looking ship aren't going to be the heroes of the film, you know?
Right.
Yeah, even the helmets let you know.
Yeah. The character designs of you know, the rebels and the Empire, like...
Yeah, the rebels have, like, a weird mushroom hat. And
yeah.
It's less threatening than the stormtrooper.
Yeah. Yeah, and they're all wearing, like, khakis and, yeah, you know, vests and stuff. And then, I mean, just... And the first time you see the stormtroopers bust in, it's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's surprising that they didn't make the stormtroopers all in black. You know, it's... I'm sure it was so that they could have Darth Vader be such a stark contrast.
Yeah.
But it's weird seeing the bad guys all in white.
I didn't even think about that.
Oh, yeah. Really?
Because I always thought of Vader in black as the bad guy, but yeah, yeah. I never thought of, well, maybe because they weren't bad to begin with.
Could be, yeah. but that's my, really one of my first points is Darth Vader, you know, that first time you see him, the character design is great, and just the way they contrast him against all the white stormtroopers is awesome. And it, the first time it cuts back to him, you know, he's choking out. Is it? I think it's Captain Antilles.
Yeah.
So.
Wow, you know that guy's name?
Oh, yeah.
Where are those transmissions you intercepted? What have you done with those plans?
We intercepted no transmissions. This is a consular ship. We're on a diplomatic mission.
If this is a consular ship, where is the ambassador? Commander, tear this ship apart until you found those plans and bring me the passengers. I want them alive.
My first note was on Darth Vader. I just now realized that he was the first RoboCop.
Yeah.
Because there's not much left of him.
No,
I mean, mostly robot and just, a jacked up face.
Yeah, I mean, basically his torso, his upper, let's think, what? Both of his legs get cut off, yeah, below the knee. One arm or one hand he lost, you know, way before. Yeah.
He's got, like, one good arm, I think. Doesn't he?
No, because Obi-Wan cuts off his...
Oh, he has it because he's reaching up. He's, like, crawling,
yeah,
out.
Yeah, but that, was, that was, he was crawling mechanical, with his mechanical.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, so, yeah, yeah, he got chopped off before, of course.
So he has no good limbs, really. And then, yeah, so he basically was just a head, a torso, and, you know, some,
yeah,
dangly bits.
RoboCop.
RoboCop, yeah.
And he is kind of a cop for the Empire, yes.
Yeah, yeah, he's...
He's an enforcer.
That's a good point.
Yeah, it just dawned on me when I started watching. I'm like, wait a second. He's RoboCop.
Yeah.
Yep. You're welcome, everyone.
We've got a new tangent. RoboCop with a lightsaber.
Oh, yeah.
Dead or alive, you're coming with me.
Except Darth Vader's voice is jacked up.
Yeah.
Yeah, other than that. Well, I'm done for the whole podcast. That's as good as it's getting from me.
Take a break.
Yep.
I always take note of the two guys that let the escape pod just go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because those two guys could have changed everything.
There goes another one.
Hold your fire. There's no life forms. It must have short-circuited.
Yeah.
But
that
we
was weird.
That like... really weird. In a world where they know droids are a thing,
exactly,
that you would just scan, yeah, for life forms and then go, ah, that's fine. Let them go.
Yeah.
It's like, why are they good all of a sudden? You figured they'd, you know, at least need the target practice.
Yeah.
Because they're horrible shots.
They're probably just itching to shoot something.
Yeah.
You mentioned the stormtroopers using the stun setting on Princess Leia. Just,
yeah.
That's the only time I think you see someone using stun in Star Wars.
Yeah. Probably definitely the only...
Well, it's got that weird circular ray, mm-hmm, thing, like it's a 50s sci-fi.
Yeah. I think that's definitely the only example of setting phasers to stun.
Yeah.
Oh, don't say that. let's see. I had, I'm kind of jumping around a little bit.
Yeah, I think it's okay to, anywhere within Act 1, I think we can talk
about.
I'm
still in that zone, but I think it was like a Starfleet leader or whatever he was, talking back to Vader.
Oh,
I thought he had some serious balls to do that. Does he not know that Vader can, like, do all this stuff? He calls him a wizard or something like that.
Don't frighten us with your sorcerer's ways, Lord Vader. That's Admiral Motti?
I think so, yeah.
Okay.
Like, I was just stunned by the arrogance of that dude.
Yeah, I'm guessing that Vader's never used the Force choke on... in the Imperial boardroom, so it's probably just like, he's got a reputation for being a little a loose cannon, but
yeah. Vader doesn't seem like it almost feels like he's just kind of a joke to everyone. Like he's a lapdog.
Well, he's definitely in that scene. He always comes across as being on, Leia says it later, being on Tarkin's leash.
Yeah.
Tarkin says, enough of this, release him.
And what of the rebellion? If the rebels have obtained a complete technical readout of this station, it is possible, however unlikely, that they might find a weakness and exploit it.
The plans you refer to will soon be back in our hands.
Any attack made by the rebels against this station would be a useless gesture, no matter what technical data they've obtained.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe. I suggest we use it.
Don't be too proud of this technological terror you've constructed. The ability to destroy a planet is insignificant next to the power of the Force.
Don't try to frighten us with your sorcerer's ways, Lord Vader. Your sad devotion to that ancient religion has not helped you conjure up the stolen data tapes, or given you clairvoyance enough to find the rebels' hidden fort.
I find your lack of faith disturbing.
Enough of this. Vader, release him.
As you wish.
I love that scene, though. That whole boardroom moment is great.
Yeah. All those guys, they all have an interesting look to them. They all look very 70s.
All sideburns. Yeah.
The guy with the mustache that you see in the background, he's in... The Clone Wars quite a lot, the character, as one of the Republic commanders.
What's his name?
I think his name's Wolf Yularen.
Wolf Yularen, yeah.
Holy hell.
Yeah, you better buckle in back. You're about to hear a lot of names being thrown around.
Well, the guy in the background, five people deep, was holy
He's
hell.
He's quite a big character in the Clone Wars, yes.
I never realized that he was in that scene. Never realized that the Clone Wars character was based on him. I'll have to check, look for that next time I watch it.
So that dude didn't stay on the Death Star, then?
Well, a lot of in Clone Wars, because that takes place before all this.
Oh, jeez, I keep forgetting that.
Crap. A lot of those Imperial guys or Republic guys think they're working for the good guys.
Yeah. Okay.
Tarkin is one of the Republic
Commanders
as well.
Yeah, this is going to screw me up the whole time. Because it looks so much more futuristic in the old, the prequels.
That was one thing I never loved about that, I get why they did it with making Phantom Menace look shinier and sleeker because they could,
it makes sense, kind of.
Kind of.
The whole universe is in shambles now, so.
That's, I think, the saving grace of it is, once the fall of the Republic, that they don't...
You got hand-me-downs.
Yeah.
I guess. That's how I always try to justify it.
Yeah.
But, that's going to screw me up, because I'm going to think, in our timeline, not in Star Wars timeline.
Yeah. And it's difficult... Not difficult. It's interesting to watch this movie and trying not to think of the prequels and everything we know beyond this movie, especially like some moments now that having seen Force Awakens, like there's character moments from, you know, Han Solo that you pay more attention to and things like that that have more weight, but you can't, you know, obviously they didn't have that all in mind when making this movie, so it's...
If you ask George Lucas, he'll tell you that, though.
Right. Well, let me call him up real quick. George, come on the show.
Hello, this is George Lucas.
Oh, hey, George.
Hello.
I have no idea what he sounds like.
Kind of like Kermit the Frog.
Hey, who? Kermit the Frog here.
My voice is too deep.
Yeah.
Hey, who?
No, I can't do it. I sound like one of the Seven Dwarfs.
Yeah.
Hey, who? Hey, who?
My impersonations are just falling, by the way. So
yeah.
There goes my career. Oh, well. So, we're still pretty early in Act 1.
Yeah. Do you have any more notes kind of in this area, Rory?
No, I don't.
Okay. My next note is I love seeing the Sandcrawler, the big tank, the red tank-looking thing
that picks up
the droids. It's obviously it's like a miniature, but it looks massive.
Yeah.
So it's a well-done miniature. And that's kind of one of my notes throughout the entire movie is how good the miniatures hold up. And,
I think my next one is the entrance of Obi-Wan.
Oh, okay.
And I thought it was pretty cool. Like, he comes in, you don't know what he is or who it is.
Yeah.
And, you know, you sort of have some inkling that because of the recording, Ben Kenobi, old Ben Kenobi or whatever.
Yeah.
So you have a feeling either they're related or it is this guy, in fact. But I just thought his entrance was kind of cool that it's sort of like, I don't know, that's where I saw, I saw Darth Vader's entrance and his entrance being kind of, you know, the two main entrances in the movie, even though Obi-Wan's it's a little smaller.
A lot of people do have just not very interesting entrances into the film, I noted down. A lot of people are just like, just walk in with no applaud. Just
Luke's is a little kind of weak. I mean, it's got a good music score, but you foresee him. He's just walking up with Owen.
Yeah.
And then, like, Han Solo doesn't get a real, interesting introduction. Princess Leia has a good introduction because you see her from C-3PO's perspective.
That's true, yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, messing with R2, and she's got that good, like, she pulls off her hood, you know, little hero shot kind of moment. But yeah, most people don't have great intros, like you said, except for Vader and Obi-Wan.
Yeah, because, I mean, with Leia, I don't know that she's a hero. I just, at the beginning, you'd think she's the damsel in distress.
Right.
As I do air quotes on the podcast.
Let's see. I have a note about when you first see R2 being, on the auction line when Owen and Luke are buying droids. Mm-hmm. So they buy, is it R5-D4? I think is the red.
Just say the red one.
It's R5-D4.
Okay. When they buy the red one. Patrick.
The red explodey one, all right?
Yeah. Jeez. As a kid, I always thought that somehow R2 was not the mentally doesn't work, but essentially I thought R2 was sabotaging the red droid because that's why he explodes and
that's what I
thought. So I always thought like, oh my god, R2 just murdered that droid.
You know about all the backstory behind that droid?
I do. you want to talk about it?
Yeah, all right. There's a few different theories. One of the theories is just that R2 destroyed them, but there are some expanded universe stories about R5-D4, the Force-sensitive droid, that is more or less a Jedi, and he knew that R2 had to go to Luke, so he destroyed himself.
Yeah. See, I always heard kind of that version, not the force sensitive part, but just that R2 explained his, he reasoned with R5 and said, I'm on this mission, I need to go with, you know, this family. And so then R5 like understood. He understood R2's mission. He sacrificed himself by killing himself. So
see, now I'm thinking that inside that red R5 D4, whatever
go.
The hell,
yep,
is a tiny hamster that's force sensitive.
Okay,
and he's like a Darth Vader-esque robot.
Okay, yeah.
So there's some like sentient life form
inside
in there,
the droid.
Which gives
okay.
him the force.
Yeah.
So hey, it just expanded that universe.
Yeah, you're not wrong. It's whatever you want it to
there's
be.
There's got
to
be some living thing in there with force powers. It's just encased in a robot shell.
I've also heard theories about the Millennium Falcon being force sensitive.
Oh, really?
It's out there, but yeah. That's okay. One of those things with the fans, you know.
Oh, yeah.
It's any theory is, you know,
yeah.
Not possible, but, you know.
Well. All
right, so we're going down a dark hole.
Yeah.
I like to think R2 destroyed them, though.
Yeah, that's how I always see it, you know.
So R2 shot first?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just checking.
One of my favorite parts of the movie, and it's just pure hero shot moment, is, you know, after Luke has been let down by Owen as far as going to the academy, mm-hmm. you know, just the looking off into the horizon hero shot of him, you know, looking at the suns and all that. Just one of my favorite moments
yeah.
in all of Star Wars.
It's such a powerful image, and the music that goes with it
yeah.
is so powerful.
It's a good example of like idyllic youth, like
yeah.
dreaming of bigger and better things, and it without words, without, you know, anything else, it just perfectly yeah. sums that up. Like you kind of know exactly who this kid is. He wants bigger and better things, but like, later when he's with Obi-Wan, you know, he says, I can't get involved and all that. Like he's got work to do. And so he's like a lot of us where he wants bigger and better things. He dreams big, but then when it comes down to action, he, you know,
yeah,
he can't see himself, you know, breaking away from his responsibilities.
Very poignant. Oh, there was a part in this, shortly after, with Luke coming back after they found out that the crawler got destroyed.
Yeah.
And I did not remember the smoking corpses
yeah.
of his aunt and uncle.
Yeah, it's a powerful image.
I was like, holy crap.
I have this in my notes because I checked this film's rating here, and it is a U, which is the lowest
okay.
rating you can get. That's like everyone can go see this.
Yeah, I think it's PG here,
yeah.
which is our lowest, like, you know, it's, well, I guess there's G rating for,
yeah, this
I
is like
a
parental
PG.
Guidance is suggested,
yeah.
but,
yeah.
Yeah, I was, normally you don't see smoking corpses,
no.
at least it was skeletons, I guess.
Yeah.
So that's probably how they got away with it.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was surprising. I did not realize,
yeah,
I don't remember that part for some reason.
Yeah, that one's it's a great scene, but yeah, it is a little shocking. Like you don't expect to see something like that
yeah.
in, you know, in a movie like this. So
right after that, you have C-3PO throwing dead Jawas on a fire.
I know.
Yeah.
I know.
Oh, good call.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So one of my other favorite fan theories is that if you watch this movie, pay attention to Obi-Wan and some of his motivations, because if there's a way to watch this movie and you see him as a very dark character. There's one theory that suggests that once Luke gets knocked out by the sand people, Obi-Wan comes across him, and then while Luke is passed out, Obi-Wan goes to the homestead, kills Owen and Beru, kills the Jawas, like sets up all of this while Luke is passed out, just to, you know, further along Luke's
push him along the path.
Yeah. And it's, you know,
that's messed up.
Yeah. Oh. I always like that theory though.
Wow.
But it kind of changes things, you know.
There's some messed up Star Wars fans.
Yeah. Another one of my favorite moments is Obi-Wan, once they're at Obi-Wan's home, him talking about the Jedi and the Force and, you know, the dark times before the Empire, all of that stuff. You know, I could watch. I always wish that scene was longer.
For over 1,000 generations, the Jedi Knights were the guardians of peace and justice in the Old Republic. Before the dark times. Before the Empire.
How did my father die?
A young Jedi named Darth Vader, who was a pupil of mine until he turned to evil, helped the Empire hunt down and destroy the Jedi Knights. He betrayed and murdered your father. Now the Jedi are all but extinct. Vader was seduced by the dark side of the Force.
The Force?
The Force is what gives the Jedi his power. It's an energy field created by all living things. It surrounds us and penetrates us. It binds the galaxy together.
And it's interesting that, you know, everything that, you know, they build up the Force and Jedis and everything, but this is really the only, for the most part, the only time they talk about the Force, or at least explaining what it does. You know, so it's interesting that so much is made of it later on.
Midichlorians?
Yeah. Well, yeah.
I knew something dorky.
Yeah, you did.
I still can't remember what they are. They're like tiny little robot force thingies that are in your blood or something.
No, they're
microscopic living beings.
Yeah, essentially it's bacteria that we all have, but they are force sensitive, and so if you have a lot of midichlorians in your blood system, then you're more force sensitive because all those bacteria, it's like a symbiont life.
Is it like an STD?
No.
Okay. Oh, great. You gave me the midichlorians.
Yeah.
So it's like something I really don't care about. Okay.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Not worth talking about.
No, okay. Moving on.
Yep.
Oh, I had one more thing.
Okay.
Sort of going back to after Luke sees the remains.
Yeah.
And then he's like, I'm going.
Yeah.
There's nothing you could have done, Luke, had you been there. You'd have been killed, too. And the droids would now be in the hands of the Empire.
I want to come with you to Alderaan. There's nothing for me here now. I want to learn the ways of the Force and become a Jedi like my father.
I can't help but thinking Obi-Wan's like, oh, great, more Skywalker revenge. I can see where this is going.
Yeah,
might as well chop off your limbs now.
Save everyone a boatload of trouble and just go ahead and cut off a hand. I like that a lot of what we see Luke do in the first act is, you know, like his father, he doesn't hesitate. You know, he runs off to the homestead to check on Owen and Beru, even after, you know, Obi-Wan says, you know, no, wait. But so we see a lot of examples of Luke just rushing into things.
Oh, I thought you were going to talk about the whininess.
Oh, see, that never bothered me. I never saw Luke as being...
He's like, but I was going to go down to the thingy and get more thingies. Yeah. I was like, there's Anakin.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess it just never bothered me that much. Because he just comes across as young, you know.
Yeah.
Well, was he meant to be like 17?
I think I always thought 19 years had passed. I mean, it's very vague with... It's between 17 and 19.
All his friends are in the army.
Yeah.
So I'm guessing we're putting our values on it, so like 18 for that.
Yeah.
17, 18. So, and then he's like behind all of them. So
right.
I'd probably say around 19.
Yeah.
Unless they're, you know, getting him into the army early.
I think when the movie was made, and obviously without knowing, you know, who Luke and Leia are related, like,
yeah, it's just
she always seems older than him, so it's hard to see her as being 19 or 17 or 19.
Well, it's just like, I mean, you got somebody grown up as a princess, that's, so you're going to be more regimented and
yeah.
I don't know. Naturally, I sort of saw Luke as sort of young Anakin and her as older Anakin, where she's like more confident and
yeah.
Knows what she wants kind of person.
Hmm.
Just looking back now,
yeah.
Like I sort of see Luke as sort of the whiny pod racer.
Sure.
but his character evolves so much throughout the series that it's crazy. Yeah. It's like a totally different character from this movie to Jedi.
It is. Okay. Yeah. But he still always has that headstrong rushing into situations kind of. And really, all of them do. Leia does it a couple times with the garbage chute. Han does it with chasing after the stormtroopers. Yeah. To you know, they all that just everyone has that.
Everyone
except for C-3PO.
Yeah.
Yeah,
me too. Being coward.
Yeah. I mean, even R2. I guess Chewie is a little more reserved. He doesn't want to go to the garbage chute. He doesn't want to, you know.
R2's like a stubborn old man. He's, like, set in his ways about the recording.
Yeah.
He won't give it up to Luke. He tricks him into turning it off.
I do always like that scene of you know, C-3PO playing it off like, oh, I don't know, he just must be old Data, you know.
That's pretty much all I have for
that one. That's pretty much all I have. So Act 1 ends with, you know, Luke returning to Obi-Wan after he discovers the homestead burning and deciding to go with Obi-Wan and become a Jedi.
And the adventure begins.
Yeah. One thing, I rewatched it this morning just to prepare.
Oh, hell.
And it stuck out to me this time that Obi-Wan just tells Luke, you know, you should come with me and learn about the Force. And it always reads like anyone could learn about the Force.
Hmm.
They don't play it up like...
Well, he knows who he is.
He knows, that he's the son of Anakin, so...
Yeah.
Yeah. But
it's a safe bet he's going to have some of those weird things in him.
But it just, in this movie, it reads like, hey, you know, I was just a Jedi Knight, same as your father, and it makes it seem like anyone can be a Jedi Knight.
Yeah, not knowing what we know.
Yeah.
I get you.
So...
Mos Eisley Spaceport. You will never find the more wretched hive of scum and villainy. We must be cautious.
And right off the bat, Act 2 starts with kind of them going into Mos Eisley. And this is one of those, the special edition really bothers me.
Yeah, me too.
Because the entire ride into Mos Eisley, you get all the CGI special edition stuff and...
They really focus in on it.
I know. You got the Jawa that falls off of he's riding it's called a Ronto. I know that because of watching the toy commercials around 97 when they were re-releasing this. They really like emphasized that you know, creature that he was riding.
I call any big animal a Tauntaun.
So that stuff always bothers me, and as the speeder is like coming towards the camera, and you've got, I think it's either a Dewback or a Ronto, like passing in front of the screen. And it's just like this wall of scaly skin. Yeah. That's, you know, and it looks really bad. So
a droid just comes after it.
A
little yellow droid just follows it across the screen as well for no reason.
Yeah, that always bothered me.
It always seems unnecessary.
Yeah, it is unnecessary.
They just jam it in there.
If you didn't know about the special editions or anything, and that was the first you'd seen it, that would be really confusing. You wouldn't know what was happening at all.
Yeah, it's jarring.
Yeah.
You know,
Well, it doesn't help that you got this practical effects movie with random bits of CG work thrown in there.
And all of this was very well. And basically, the special editions were a test to see if they could do Phantom Menace. That was the entire reason for adding special effects to, you know.
Because I saw these remastered ones in theaters.
Yeah.
Like, I remember going to see all of them.
See, I didn't. I wish I had, but.
Because that was, like, my sweet spot, because I was, like, in my teens when that came, hitting the theaters.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that was the first time I saw, you know, the original Star Wars, but not really the original Star Wars.
Sure.
In a theater.
And I don't remember what the reaction was in 97 when all those came out. I know, obviously, Phantom Menace reaction wasn't good, but I don't remember anyone talking about...
It was basically, screw you, Lucas, you could still take my money, but screw you anyway.
Yeah.
Because everyone saw it, even though it was painful. They were still seeing Star Wars in a theater.
Right.
So you got an audience automatically, even though you botched it up. I don't think people were that stoked about it. They were excited in theory, like, oh, we get to see, you know, all this new stuff and special effects. I mean, but it just wasn't executed the way that it probably should have been.
Right.
I remember everyone freaking out about what's his face, Jabba, being able to see him.
That is,
which is another horrible.
Yeah, that's a low point for me.
But I remember that being a big deal, that you could see him moving.
Yeah.
Like, he's not just sitting there.
Right. Yeah. One of my next points is that the cantina could have been a disaster.
I could have sworn I remembered a worse cantina scene with, like, singing aliens.
You'll get there. Yeah. That's in Return of the Jedi.
Okay.
Yep.
I thought that was in this one.
That's in Jabba's palace in Jedi.
Yeah.
We'll get there.
I was pleasantly surprised
because
I didn't see that.
Right. So
but
yeah,
now I know it's coming. Awesome.
Cantina holds up really well. Some of the aliens look a little cheesy and you know, just rubber masks or whatever, but the scene itself, just seeing all those different aliens, it still works.
I meant to say something earlier in the scene where he, you know, these are not the droids you're looking for.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Does that work on everybody that's around?
I always wonder about that, because you'd think the guy next to the
like, hey, screw you, buddy. Command, these, like, are the droids we're looking for.
Sir, are you sure you want to...
I think stormtroopers are just like, if they get an order, they'll just follow it. If their commander is agreeing with the guy, then they'll agree with the guy. They don't really care enough to...
Yeah.
So they're literally lemmings.
Yeah. They're just following orders, you know.
Just following orders. Okay, just curious, side note.
No, that's a good...
That always bugged me.
Yeah, and it always bothers me that Luke can't understand what's going on. Like, it's right in front of his face. Like, I don't understand how we got past those troops, you know? It's like, God damn it, Luke, pay attention.
Does he not know anything about the Force whatsoever?
When Obi-Wan says, you know... In his home is talking about the Force, and Luke's like has a question, you know, quizzical look on his face, and he's like, the Force?
So his aunt and uncle just kept him in the dark purposely.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Oh, yeah. If you rewatch it, you know, you see Owen just telling him to drop it and forget all about Obi-Wan, or the name Kenobi and all that stuff. So, yeah, he's obviously been kept in the dark about...
Like, I thought it was like a famous religion, so...
I think it is. It's a mythological, more legend than
even
famous.
Even though it's only been like 20 years.
Yeah. But
it's a myth in 20 years.
That's and crazy. Especially for Luke on Tatooine, he's never been told about the Force or, you know, like his uncle, I think, made sure that he was kept in the dark about his family and all of that stuff.
Because he doesn't have any cool friends that know about the Force.
Yeah, yeah. And it works in this movie because we don't know anything about the Force, you know. It works when you don't know about the prequels, for sure.
Yeah. I think that's the hard part of watching these.
Yeah.
Is forgetting what you know.
Right. Being objective. Yeah.
Because, like, right now, I think Darth's all right. Darth's just following orders.
Yeah, he's just a space cop.
Yeah. He's like that cop in the Lego movie.
Hey, buddy.
He was pretty reasonable with Leia.
Yeah. Yeah.
He wasn't the one that blew up the planet.
Right.
he was complimenting her, for crying out loud.
That's true. That her resistance to the mind probe is considerable.
Yeah.
Which you think would be like
a tipping point. So, yeah, you know, tipping him off. Maybe she's got the force.
Yeah.
I always thought it was weird he couldn't sense, like, his kids.
Yeah, I mean, spoilers. He senses Luke.
Spoilers.
Right.
Sorry.
He does sense Luke at the end of the movie, but just by saying the force is strong with this one.
Yeah, he doesn't know that it's...
Yeah, but that's as far as, you know...
I don't know, I just thought that was interesting that he can't tell.
Right.
Like his... Because he could tell, like, from distance that Padme bit the bullet.
Yeah.
Right? And he knew it was her force. Like, do you just get used to maybe somebody's presence in the force, I'm guessing?
I think so, because
he just hasn't felt their presence before?
Well, yeah, that's one way of looking at it. I mean, he obviously, when
Obi-Wan
is on the Death Star, he's like, I sense a presence that I haven't felt since, you know.
Okay, so you just got to get used to something. Just wanders
off, makes sense.
Yeah. I always wonder what that officer thinks. Yeah. Like, why is he telling me this? It's out of character for Vader to be like, yeah, I sense this presence that it's like, why are you talking to this guy?
Oh my god.
That's what this movie could have used, was some Heston.
Oh, hell yeah. He could have been that commander dude that was in charge of Vader. Can't remember his name, even though you said it.
Tarkin?
Yeah. I could have seen him as that guy. It's like, ooh, we're going to destroy this planet now.
I mean, that's one thing that this movie could have gone a lot worse. Like, originally, Burt Reynolds was considered for Han Solo. You know, I mean, there are casting choices that could have, like, made this movie weird.
Yeah. Smokey and the Bandit.
Yeah, well,
it's pretty
not
close.
Far off.
Yeah. I mean, he's not smuggling Coors Light across the universe, but
yeah. let's see. So we're still at the.
Well, we can jump around.
Yeah, that's true. My next point was just how bad the Jabba scene in the in docking bay 94.
Holy shit.
It's...
Are you serious? You know the number?
That's actually in my notes as well. I have 94 written down, because he repeats 94, Obi-Wan repeats
it. Yeah, that's one of those...
A famous line.
Yeah, 94. It's one of those secret Star Wars quotes that anytime you hear the number 94, you say, like, 94.
I was going to say airport hangar.
Okay.
I don't know. I was... Holy hell. I'm in, like, a... I'm out of my league here.
Yeah.
Jeez. Do you know the guy that landed the ship, too? Jeez.
What do you mean?
You know, the guy with the flashlights that brings him in or whatever?
I don't know. He's one of the few people
that don't know. I don't think he got an action figure.
It's Lars Markinson.
It is now. Anyway, so just the addition of Jabba to that scene is...
Because he wasn't in that scene at all before, right?
Well,
that scene didn't exist before.
Yeah, okay, it was
cut, and it was just a guy in a vest. Jabba.
The original Jabba was a man.
Okay.
So this scene was just a cut scene. You know, it was a deleted scene that they added back into it once they added the digital Jabba.
Okay.
And it doesn't hold up because, for one, Jabba doesn't look great. He doesn't look like he does later. And then you got the scene where Han walks behind Jabba.
And
originally, he's just walking behind a man.
Yeah.
So if you watch Han, he like has this weird digital transition where he's as he's stepping on Jabba, it gets real blurry and just choppy.
Yeah.
Because that's just how they had to – that's one of those things that now I wish they would go back and fix it and make it – perfect, make that scene seamless if they're going to keep that scene in the rest of the movie. Because it bothers me that it still looks so crappy. So it's one of those that...
There's not much need for that scene anyway. You can see why they can't. Because he pretty much has the same conversation with Greedo just before
Part of it is verbatim.
Yeah.
I mean, actually take the audio from the scene where Han Solo says, even I get bored sometimes. You think I had a choice?
Yeah.
That line is repeated in both scenes in the Han versus Greedo and Han versus Jabba. That dialogue is cut and pasted both places. So it is an unnecessary scene. I wish they wouldn't have, because it ruins the reveal of Jabba later on.
Yeah.
And you have Jabba being friendly with him, calling him, Han Mabuki or Han my boy. Like, it's like.
Wait, you speak Jabba?
I do speak Huttese.
What am I doing?
Now you get why I preempted all of this with James Bond and Planet of the Apes, just to lure you in.
Yep, I am screwed. Okay.
Yeah.
I thought it was weird he stepped on him, like, to begin with. I mean, doesn't he owe this guy money and is like a big deal?
It shows the entire lack of respect for Jabba.
He's surrounded by bounty hunters. So.
Yeah, and we get Boba Fett,
who wasn't in this originally, correct?
He was in that scene, but he wasn't a character. I mean, he was a nobody.
Okay, because I thought he got introduced
in Empire.
Yeah. So was he physically in the original first one, like the new Hope?
They might have added him digitally.
Or was he digitally added?
I was wondering that myself. I'm not sure.
Because I always remember hearing the story of lost his name. Boba Fett. Not showing up until later.
Yeah. I mean, in the originals, because this whole scene was cut, originally Boba Fett would have appeared in Empire along with all the bounty hunters that Vader sends to find the Millennium Falcon.
I think he might have been there, though, because the design must have existed, because he's in a cartoon in the holiday special.
That's true.
That's what I was just going to say. I thought it was the holiday thing that he was introduced in.
And that was maybe just the year after this, so.
Yeah.
Okay.
But he has this weird, like, turn to the camera as if it's like, I'll
hey
be
guys.
Back, I don't know. It's strange.
So he's the first Deadpool?
Mercenary, kind of.
Get the introduction of the Falcon. They call it a hunk of junk.
Yeah.
What a piece of junk!
She'll make 0.5 past light speed. She may not look like much, but she's got it where it counts, kid. I've made a lot of special modifications myself. But we're a little rushed, so if you'll just get on board, we'll get out of here.
I always find that interesting, because I've always loved the design of the ship and everything like that, and everyone refers to it as a piece of trash, basically. And
yeah.
It looks like the best thing I've seen in the movie so far.
Yeah.
Other than the, the mega ship.
The Star Destroyer.
Yeah. But I mean, looking at like all the crap that's around it, it doesn't look like it's out of place. It looks like any other ship.
I mean, and essentially it's a freighter. It's a semi, Han Solo is a truck driver.
Smokey and the Bandit.
Smokey and the Bandit. So I like thinking of it that way. Like, why would Luke be impressed with it? It's just a semi,
Yeah, but he's also like a water farmer.
Yeah.
I mean, come on.
What was he expecting?
Right.
It's like a stealth bomber to be in there?
What? Yeah.
He's paying a guy to get him off the planet, really. Like.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's more because they're trying to go fast, and it doesn't look a fast.
Yeah.
Because if you put it in the text of a semi,
you
don't think fast with a semi. It's long hauling.
Yeah.
So maybe that's what it's sort of. He was thinking something sleeker.
Right.
Which I'm still amazed that thing can go to light speed. Because it's got a satellite dish on it.
I know. They could just shear off of there.
It's not the most aerodynamic looking.
Yeah.
It's got all these weird nooks and crannies.
Yeah. But you don't have to be aerodynamic in space, so you could fly a box and it'd be,
Well, you also can't blow up in space either.
That's true. There's Star Wars science, and then there's real-life science. So.
Yeah. But it would look pretty lame if it just was like something hit them, and then it just veered.
Yeah.
I don't know what that would even look like. If I guess there's an explosion from, like, the oxygen inside.
Yeah.
So we'll go with that.
Okay.
There's no oxygen inside the TIE fighter, though. Sorry to get totally geeky about it.
That's true.
They're in a vacuum.
That's why they wear helmets inside it as well.
Oh, man. Well, I tried to save it. Thanks a lot, guys.
We reject your theories.
So Santa Claus isn't real either, right? Jeez. Killing me.
Let's see. What else we got?
I liked Han's motivation.
Yeah.
Once they get to the Death Star or whatever, he's like, wait, she's a princess?
Right. Money?
I can imagine quite a bit of money, kid.
Yeah.
We've got to do something. What are you talking about? The droid belonged to her. She's the one in the method. We got to help her.
Now look, don't get any funny ideas. The old man wants us to wait right here.
But he didn't know she was here. We could just find our way back into the detention block.
I'm not going anywhere.
They're gonna execute her. Look, a few minutes ago you said you didn't want to just wait here to be captured. Now all you want to do is stay?
Marching into the detention area is not what I had in mind.
But they're gonna kill her!
Better her than me.
She's rich.
Rich?
Rich, powerful. Listen, if you were to rescue her, the reward would be...
What?
Well, more wealth than you can imagine.
I don't know. I can imagine quite a bit.
You'll get it.
I better.
You will.
I was like, that is a true character right there.
Yeah, yeah, I mean, true it's to his very, heart. Like, in your face. Yeah. Like, hey, you're going to get... And I love that Luke has no idea if he's going to get a reward.
No. Yeah. I like that. It's Luke's just like, yeah, whatever. Just come with us. Yeah, you'll get money, riches, more than you can imagine. He has no idea. And
just
like,
before that was the point that Chewie actually does something physical. He punches a guy.
Oh, yeah, yeah. When they open the door, he just smacks
Paul Treatham.
Paul Treatham, yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah.
You guys are just going to freak me out.
But that guy must be dead, surely. A punch like that.
A punch from... I think I read or heard that that guy escapes, but maybe not him. I don't know.
Wow,
I'm thinking about a different guy.
They go into that amount of detail.
Everyone has a backstory.
Yeah. Everyone.
Yeah.
That's awesome, but sad at the same time.
Yeah. Let's see. Wow. I want to back up real quick and talk about the Tarkin and Leia scene that we get.
Oh, yeah. Duh.
Is awesome.
Yeah.
I mean... just the two of them, and they're very, like, scenery chewing, you know, just, you know, overly dramatic. But that's, Peter Cushing, the guy playing Tarkin, is very classically trained British actor. And just all those, he's rolling all of his R's. And, I mean, I guess to Rory it probably sounds like normal, you know. To us it sounds very regal and,
I love when he grabs her face. That's... properly grabs her face.
It was a hot moment.
The sexual tension is palpable.
Yeah.
I just always love their interaction.
Yeah.
Obviously, leading to the destruction of Alderaan is pretty epic.
Then when it cuts back and he's like, I can't believe she lied to me.
Yeah, yeah.
Like he was a scorned lover.
Lied to us.
And after I blew up her planet and everything.
Yeah.
Jeez.
But it's
no honor.
Right. It's an impressive move by Leia. I mean, they threaten her planet. She gives them a fake location for the base. And once they do that, they have nothing that they can hold over her. Yeah. Really. You know. So, it's, you know, she's kind of balancing, you know, the rebel base versus, you know, her home planet. And it's,
well, I mean,
it's interesting that she sacrifices, you know.
Well, I mean, in her mind, she may have been like, okay, I'll give them this planet, maybe buy some time while they check it out.
Yeah. Obviously, that was her motivation.
It wasn't that cold. I mean,
No. And I don't fault her for that. It's,
It was a smart, shrewd move to do that. But, it was impressive.
Yeah. I want to talk about the kind of cut back to the scene on the Falcon as they're traveling to Alderaan. We obviously have the great scene with Luke training against the remote, and just the Han talking about the Force and all that it's especially after seeing that initially the first trailer for Force Awakens, when he's talking about the Force being real, all of it is true. That's this scene now has a little bit more impact for me.
Yeah. That scene's almost in the same place as well.
Yeah, that's true. Kind of they're traveling from one place to the other.
I think it's definitely in the same room in the ship as well.
That's true, yeah. Same place on the ship, yeah.
The chess room?
Yeah, the kind of the common area, really. It's the lounge.
Yeah, that was another odd piece of CG, the chessboard.
Well, that was original.
Yeah, stop motion.
Yeah, stop. Yeah, the characters are all stop motion, and they just,
put a light.
Change the opacity or change the transparency to give it that hologram look. Yeah.
I thought that was CG.
No,
that hologram look.
That's all original.
Impressive then.
Yeah.
Because it looked fake, but
that's what's kind of cool about it is that it still holds up because it looks like a crappy video game.
Yeah.
We've had that. Looks like an 8-bit, it's their version.
Now I'm even more pissed at the CG work.
Right?
Wow. I was going to say that was the best CG work in the movie.
No, that was all practical.
Good Lord. I think I'm just expecting CG with any trained shot on, animated figures.
Sure.
Just expecting it to be CG.
It was an amazing amount of restraint that they didn't replace it with CG.
I think people probably would have walked out. That's one of those things that is... It doesn't,
sacred.
Ultimately, it doesn't matter, but yeah, it's sacred.
Yeah. Oh, that's impressive. I can see why they'd be pissed.
Yeah.
I had a part that I thought was odd.
Okay.
Maybe they're just that cocky, but they had a lot of unsecured access points for data and I swear he was plugging in every 5 steps. It just struck me as odd.
There's no security, anyone can just plug in.
And they're randomly located in areas you can hide. It's okay. I mean, I understood the control room, but then once they were out of there, they found another one, and it felt like there was 15 more along the way that you could have gotten into.
And that comes back to bite R2 in the ass later in Empire. But
I remember that one. I was expecting that in this one.
Oh, okay, sure.
I think I've just seen them all, so they all blend in my head.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Because they have common scenes, kind of.
At this point, when they're rescuing the princess and Obi-Wan is sneaking around the Death Star, I have a really hard time taking notes from here until they leave the Death Star, because it's very easy to get sucked in.
And just
want to just watch it,
I liked Han being awkward on the microphone with...
that's one of my favorite scenes
ever. Okay, here. Yeah. Everything's... Super duper. Oh, shoot. Damn it. Boom.
How are you?
Everything's under control. Situation normal.
What happened?
Had a slight weapons malfunction, but everything's perfectly all right now. We're fine. We're all fine here now. Thank you. How are you?
We're sending a squad up.
Negative. We have a reactor leak here now. Give us a few minutes to lock it down. Large leak. Very dangerous.
Who is this? What's your operating number?
We're in conversation anyway. Luke, we're gonna have company!
I love that part.
I do too.
Because he's supposed to be this smooth talk. I always had in my head that he was just knew what to say. And
that's one of those, Han is, he's kind of bumbling. He stumbles into a lot of situations. Think about... Anytime he's piloting the Falcon, not necessarily in this one so much, but in the later movies, the Falcon never does what he wants it to do. He's always it's not my fault. It's things never work out for him, but he's still that hero, that everyone's favorite,
Doesn't he, like, hit Rogue. Stuff, like, in the Falcon?
Yeah, just kind of smacks it to get things to... Yeah.
It's like the old jalopy that you just got to hit it right. And...
Right. Made a lot of special modifications to it myself. I like Leia taking over the rescue. Yeah. She's very, like, strong-willed and headstrong. And I love that she just gives them no end of, like, shit. Just, you know, some rescue and just always talking back to Han. And so it shows that she's, you know, we've already seen her with Tarkin and Vader, how she's, you know, she's got a lot of spirit. So it's just nice that she's never a damsel in distress like you think she's going to be.
Yeah. I liked her. I like the scene that she gets them into, the trash compactor scene.
Yeah.
It was, I remember that being tense when I first watched it.
Sure. And it still kind of tense once they're, like, really getting
Well, even the little compacted. The thing swimming around. Like,
yeah, Dianoga.
Like,
Dianoga.
Holy
Oh,
how?
This is fun.
Dianoga?
Yeah.
What the? Who names that thing?
That's your buddy George Lucas.
Did he come out with a book that I didn't read?
Yeah. He originally he wrote, like, it's all started in 73. He wrote the Journal of the Wills, which was just a, like, 2 or 3 page kind of manuscript of names, places, you know, and a lot of those names, I wrote it down. Let's see.
I'm comparing Star Wars with the Harry Potter universe now.
Hanga, yeah.
Because there's a bunch of crazy crap that goes on in that one as well.
Yeah.
Like, weird characters.
Yeah, Lucas began writing it in January of 73, coming up with all the names and of people and places. The 2-page synopsis was called The Journal of the Wills. It was about the training of apprentice C.J. Thorpe, who was a Jedi Bendu space commando being trained by Mace Windu. So Mace Windu will become Mace Windu, which will come into play later. Yeah, he wrote all this stuff down, just kind of creating the mythology of it before writing the true story.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
That's a lot of work.
It's kind of like Tolkien did that. Like, he was a professor or a professor of language.
Mm-hmm.
And so writing The Hobbit was just a backstory to wrap around creating the language that he developed or invented. So.
Are we talking about Elvish?
All of it, like Elvish.
There's more than one? Crap.
Yeah. There's many forms of... There's Tengwar, there's, like, all kinds of languages in the Lord of the Rings universe.
That's what I'm in. I don't follow any of that stuff.
Okay.
All right.
All right, we'll stop talking about that.
Yeah, but what a nerd, am I right, Rory? Holy crap. Okay.
Anyways... Let's get back to the, where were we? Oh, the Dianoga.
Yeah. the eye-popping water monster.
Yeah.
Dianoga. Does he have the Force, too?
I don't believe so. Stop. I don't know any backstory of how what that is or why it's there, why it's in there or anything. I don't know anything about it. I just know what it's called.
I think I just, in my head canon, which just my version of why this thing's there.
Oh, I thought you had a super awesome power.
Oh, yeah.
My head
canon. No, that's what you call it, like your version of, like, the backstory or why things are. In my version, I always think of the Dianoga as being there in every trash compactor has a Dianoga in order to eat whatever organic material might be there, any, you know, food scraps, because it's a trash compactor, so they don't want a bunch of, you know, trash or organic. Trash.
Yeah.
So it's just there. It's a garbage disposal, basically.
What happens when you think you compact it?
Well, when you hear when they kick in the compactor noise, it lets Luke go and escapes. So I imagine it has, like, a secret little hidey hole that it escapes to.
A Dianoga hole?
Yeah.
Or whatever his name is.
Now you got it.
Okay.
You're never going to be able to forget that.
Dianoga.
Now. Next time you watch this, you're going to think, hey, there's the there's my old buddy Dianoga.
Yeah. The true hero of the movie.
Yeah.
He gets killed in the explosion then.
Yeah. Aww. He is one of the...
Poor Dianoga.
Yeah.
He didn't do nothing to nobody.
While they're in there and the droids, one of the stormtroopers gets told to guard that room, and then he just lets the droids out.
Right.
What does she think he's guarding? Like, what?
Yeah, guard this empty room with two corpses in it. I've never thought about that. That's a good point.
Why weird is he not in that room if it's not for the two droids?
Right. Who are, I forget, they're hiding in a closet. They're hiding and then they find them. Yeah. And then they tell them to guard the room. Yeah. I don't know.
It's like they don't care about droids at all, even though they could play an integral role.
Well, especially the entire first act is all about finding two droids.
Yeah. It's like, oh, they're just droids. Let them go.
Yeah.
5 minutes later. Yeah, just let them go.
Gentlemen, I think we found ourselves a plot hole.
Yeah. They're droidists.
Yeah. They don't see. They can't differentiate between two droids.
Like, all droids look alike.
Yeah.
Even though C-3PO is a pretty distinct-looking droid from what I've seen so far.
Yeah, there's a couple.
Are there a lot of gold-plated droids?
There's a silver one on the Tantive IV, the blockade runner at the beginning of the movie.
What?
My ears want to throw names out to you.
Yeah. I can't unremember this.
Yeah.
I'm probably losing valuable information right now.
Oh, yeah.
Taking
no, this
in
is
all
definitely,
the Star Wars crap.
You probably have forgotten your daughter's birthday.
Yeah. Oh, my.
Well, speaking of that, then, the two stormtroopers that have a chat while Obi-Wan's hiding from them.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, if you've seen those new BT-16s, that's one of my favorite lines.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Stormtroopers talking like normal people. Just having a
I heard the other guy's talking about it.
Yeah.
Oh, is that Larry and Carl, these stormtroopers?
Yeah.
Good lord. Aren't they all clones right now?
No.
Or are they mixed together?
No, these guys are all, like, post-cloning stormtroopers.
Okay, so the cloning technology is gone for the most part?
Yeah.
Okay. Because I knew that one planet had that created the clones.
Yeah. But
I thought there were other... I don't know. I thought there was other people doing cloning, but maybe not.
I mean, as far as for stormtrooper use, between the events of the prequels and now, the cloning process has been proven to be ineffective as far as producing clones, because the original material was Jango Fett. Like genetic material has kind of degraded over time.
Okay.
So it's,
find a new source?
You'd think so, because really, it's effective. I mean, using clones, you can breed and, train does seem to work.
Because I would have gotten my hands on, one of the many Jedi corpses.
Yeah, I mean...
Start cloning the hell out of those.
I like the idea of the clone troopers later on. Or before this, obviously, but...
Yeah.
Now, that part works.
Okay, so they're a mixed bag.
But these are just, anyone can join the...
Gotcha.
You either join the...
So they do have families.
You haven't seen Force Awakens. Damn it!
I think that's even different from how it is meant to be here.
That's true.
Because, I know the expanded universe stuff isn't canon, but...
Yeah.
The backstory between Ryan Han Solo as he was joining the Imperial Navy before he became a smuggler.
Yeah. Like the pants that Han Solo wears, like the red stripe down the side, that's like those were his part of his uniform from being in the Imperial Navy. But
he was just a snazzy dresser.
No. And that's one of those things that always confused me with kind of going back to the first act when Luke wants to join the Academy, and I was always confused as to what the Academy is, because it sounds like you're joining the Empire, But I always thought, why would Luke want to join the Empire?
But then you see later that he finds one of his buddies in the Rebel Alliance.
And... Well, who had left the Academy.
Oh, is that what it is?
To become a Rebel. Yeah, so...
So yeah, he was going to...
He would have been working for the Empire, yeah.
But, hanging out with Dad.
Yeah.
No big deal.
Father, take your son probably to work promoted. Day. Probably get
promoted. Oh, he's the Vader's kid.
Yeah.
No wonder he's a commander already.
Right.
And that's where we're going to end this episode, citizens. Join us next time for the conclusion of Star Wars, Episode 4, A New Hope. We want to thank Rory for being our first guest. Be sure to check out his show, Hangover Reviews, on YouTube, and follow him everywhere else at Hangover Reviews.